our first Senate candidate. We have with us NARFE leader, who is Dr. Toxicology, Dr. Bruce Fowler.
I get the gavel by Dr. Ballard. Got it. I get the honor of letting you finish your sentence, but not start another.
Okay.
Those are the ground rules.
Got it.
I have a series of questions that I'm privileged to ask you on behalf of everyone here in the room. You will have a minute and a half to answer them. And we'll see where we go. I understand you need to leave for another event. And so at about 2:40, I'll be posing the opportunity to you to have a closing statement.
That's great. Thank you, Evelyn, and I appreciate your flexibility. And I'll be got notification later about this event. So I appreciate you all working with us to make sure that we could fit all of our events into today's business.
Exactly. Exactly. We're happy to have you here. Now let's get right down to what are your top two or three priorities if you're elected to represent Maryland.
One of the issues I'm very passionate about are veterans' issues. I'm proud my father is a 20-year career Army veteran. I grew up as an Army brat. My dad did two tours in Korea and one tour in Vietnam. And, you know, honorably served our country. And for all of the veterans out here today, I'd like to thank you for your service to our country. And I want to tell you that I'm very disappointed with the way that we're treating our veterans. I don't think it's a Democrat issue or a Republican issue, but we have a moral imperative to take care of our veterans. And as I travel across our great state, I've met so many wonderful men and women that have served in our military who are not getting their needs met. I think of a man I met in Aberdeen who lost his hearing in the Middle East in one ear. It took him 5 years to get an appointment to get that hearing aid, and that hearing aid cost $5,000. So he didn't have the money to just go purchase a hearing aid. I hear about people who wait 700 days for a doctor's appointment. That's not acceptable. And my opponent, Kristen Holland, has been in Congress for 14 years. Over that time, things have not gotten better for our veterans. So I think at this point, he's making some promises about what he'd like to do for our veterans, but actions speak louder than words. Matter of fact, just this week, Van Hollen opposed H.R. 5620, the VA Accountability First and Appeals Modernization Act. And this was a bill that was aimed at helping our veterans. It did pass in a bipartisan fashion. And two Democrats from Maryland's delegation did support that bill, but Congressman Van Hollen did not. I want to go to Washington to be a champion.
Excuse me.
I was finishing my sentence. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you support privatizing the VA?
I think in some cases we have to look at how our veterans are getting a doctor's appointment. If it takes 700 days for a veteran to see a doctor, that's simply not acceptable. So if we have to find a way for that man or woman, because this is about the men and women who serve our country. And if they're in a rural part of our state and they can't get to a facility, we in Maryland have some amazing facilities for our veterans. And we need to preserve them. But our veterans across our great state may live hours from a facility. So allowing them to go outside of the VA to get health care is something we absolutely must look at, because if the VA cannot deliver timely, quality care for the men and women that serve our country, then we have to consider that as an option, yes.
Thank you.
My books are on TRICARE. That works great. They're very happy with it.
What have you done to show you're a strong advocate for seniors and government employees and retirees and their beneficiaries? What do you think are the most important needs of those constituencies, and how would you address them?
Well, you know, I have to tell you, my favorite job that God has graced me with in life is being a grandmother. If I had known that being a grandmother was as wonderful as it is, I would have had 10 children. And, you know, I think so fondly of my, you know, people say, you made some heroes in your life, and I would name Abraham Lincoln and my grandmother. My grandmother, Kitty, lived to be 103 and was just the most precious, wonderful woman in the world. And benefits and the promises that we've made to our seniors. And my parents are seniors, my mother-in-law. And so a commitment that we've made to our seniors is something that we have to keep. And so as your next U.S. Senator, you can count on me keeping the promises that we've made to our seniors and making sure they have things like Medicare or D that my opponent voted against, making sure that they have access to doctors. And that is a problem we keep hearing with Medicare, is access to physicians that will take Medicare.
Thank you.
I need Bruce out, I can see him holding
down. And what about your views on Social Security, and how would you improve the long-term viability of that program?
Sure, that's so important now, Glenn. And, you know, it's another example of career politicians who kick the can down the road on this important issue. So we have two grown sons, they're 30 and 29, and they're both married. And, of course, you couldn't skip my little baby, Avery. And so I look at my kids, and I ask them, do you think there'll be Social Security for you? And I bet if you ask your kids, they will tell you the same things my kids say, which is no. And little Avery can barely talk, so I can't ask for you. So we have to keep the promise of Social Security that we've made to people who are retired and nearing retirement. I myself have planned for my retirement. I'm a small business owner. And so my retirement is based on what I've saved, what my husband and I have saved as a small business owner. So I know we have to keep those promises because that's part of people's, financial planning for their future. But we have to find some ways to make sure that our kids and grandkids will actually have Social Security, because at the current rate, we're not going to have it. So we need people who aren't going to get to their partisan corners and use rhetoric to gin people up, to pull their sleeves up, and actually work together to solve this massive problem facing our country.
Have you, or how will you, continue to work to strengthen the dwindling middle class, especially among the seniors?
That's a great question. And I'm middle class. I think if we ask all of us here in the room, are you middle class? We all mostly feel like, we were fortunate to fit in that. I think back to when my husband and I, 36 years ago, Mark and I lived. We had $5 in our pockets, no car, and minimum wage jobs. We just believed the Beatles, all you need is love. And we believed in the American dream. We believed in this great country. You could rise up from a minimum wage job to a middle class citizen. That this unique, amazing country affords each of us the opportunity to succeed. And then 30 years ago, Mark and I started a small business. We're in construction, so certainly I've been a working class family. We still are employed lots of blue collar folks over the decades that we've been in business. And I can tell you what hinders the middle class the most is taxes, and what hinders business from creating jobs and moving people into the middle class are regulations. Over the last 7 years, more than $743 billion worth of regulations have been passed out of Washington, D.C. And this is hampering middle class people and the jobs and the businesses that employ them. I got your signals.
You're doing great.
Most studies are showing that middle-class Americans do not have retirement funds necessary to support themselves in retirement. What are your thoughts on this, and how can we assist more Americans to save for their future when they seem to be living paycheck to paycheck?
That's another great question. And I did vote in Annapolis to set up a retirement program for people that don't have one. As a business owner, we've had a SARSEP plan for our employees in the past, and I know it's a big problem. We need to educate our youth on financial literacy, of course, is so very important. And having people understand, Social Security was not supposed to be every dollar that you live on in your retirement. that we all need to save for our retirement. And, you know, we're all living much, much longer than we used to. Like I said, my grandmother lived to be 103 and her brother to 104. And so, yeah, I'm saving for my retirement because there's a good chance I'm going to live to be 100. At least I hope so. And, you know, we need to make sure that we're instilling financial literacy in all of our kids. I think it's an important part of the education system, K-12. That they understand the value of time and money, investing in your future, making a investing in your retirement, and knowing, making sure that we find a way to solve this problem for our kids and grandkids so that there will be some kind of social security left for them, but not just kick the can down the road.
Thank you. What about your views on...
Bruce and I have a signal going here.
Yes,
Medicare, you know, when I talk to seniors across our great state, which I have to tell you, it's been such a joy. I got in this election, I entered the race November 10th, and, you know, over this last, I guess, 10 months, I've been fortunate to travel across our state and meet so many amazing Marylanders and hear their concerns and hear about their joys and successes. And, you know, one thing I do hear from seniors is access to physicians. And, you know, the Affordable Care Act has turned out to be anything but affordable. You know, we have a 25% increase in premiums coming up here for next year's enrollment. And we have folks that have Medicare that are having trouble getting access to doctors. And this is really, you know, you all are fortunate to live right here in Montgomery County, where it's urban and there's plenty of healthcare providers. But if you live in the rural parts of our state and rural parts of our country, it's more and more difficult to find a healthcare provider. So, you know, this is something that as your next senator, I'm going to work on making sure that our citizens who live in the rural parts of our state have the same access to quality healthcare and quality physicians that those who live in the urban parts of our country and our state have.
Thank you. Let's switch gears totally. What would you do to make college more affordable? Do you have ideas about the relieving student debt?
Yes, that's education is something I'm quite passionate about. As you heard me say earlier, I looked when I was 18. I dropped out of college, and so did my husband, because all we had was love. And I knew the value of a college education, so I went back to college as an adult with two children and put myself through school, graduating. I think I was 32 from Towson State University with a degree in elementary education. So I know what it's like to be a non-traditional student, and I know how tough it is to push yourself through college. And I hear a lot of people talk about freeing up money so that our students get access to more money, but not enough people talking about the affordability aspect of college. And why is it that college tuition has, you know, exponentially grown, the cost of a college education? But then we also don't talk about workforce issues. So we have right now a system where our kids are told in high school that their only happy future is a four-year college degree. They go off to college, come home with $100,000 worth of college loans. In the meantime, we have many, many jobs, 3 million jobs unfilled. Truck drivers, carpenters, lawyers. I mean, well, plenty of lawyers. Truck drivers, carpenters, and welders. But we need doctors, lawyers, and physicians. But, you know, we also need welders, carpenters. So we need to make sure our kids are presented with a full plate of opportunity that is trades and college, and that will help with the future of our country.
Thank you. I listened now to the very end of your sentence.
I ended your period.
Let's talk about the federal community. Many people in this room are employed by the federal government. volunteers at the community has contributed over $120 billion in deficit reduction. And when you look at lost income from very small or no raises, that figure rises to $159 billion. What action would you take to prevent the federal community from receiving more cuts?
You know, Maryland is fortunate to be so close to Washington. We have so many federal employees that live in our state. And so I have lots and lots of friends. I live in Baltimore County, and so, of course, friends that work at Social Security Administration, especially a big employer in the Baltimore County region. And we know that wages were frozen. And so making sure that we're addressing the needs of our federal workers is really important. You know, not quite as important for folks who potentially senators from Iowa or other states that do not have as many federal employees as Maryland does. And so I know that I would just let you know, I would oppose shutting down the federal government. I think that's a terrible solution, and it not just hurts our federal employees. But I have a lot of friends who are contractors with the federal government, and when that happened the last time, federal employees were made whole, and they were retroactively paid for that time. But the friends of mine that were contractors for the federal government were not. And so many, many small businesses were harmed by that, and I want to assure you that that would not be a solution for Senator Szeliga.
Thank you. This is a specific question for you in that you have called yourself the Republican Barbara Mikulski. Do you want to share with us, other than your common gender, what your policy similarities are?
Sure. So when Barbara Mikulski said she was retiring, I thought, gosh, let's put a taller, younger Polish girl for Baltimore in the U.S. Senate line. So we not only Mikulski Szeliga, obviously both Polish girls from Baltimore, obviously I'm a little taller than her, a little younger. But you know, one thing that I do admire, and I think we all admire about Barbara Mikulski, is that she puts Maryland first. She loves Maryland. She loves Baltimore. She loves the people of this great state, and so do I. She also shares that blue-collar background that I have. You know, when you work in construction, I'll tell you what you learn. You got to roll your sleeves up and get things done. You have to work with people, regardless of their background. When you're in business, you know, you don't ask those questions. You just say, how are we going to get the job done? And so I look forward to carrying on her legacy of good constituent services. That's probably the best part. Again, running for office and holding office, being able to solve problems and help people who feel like no one cares about them and no one cares about the problems in front of them.
Thank you. And we're very sensitive to the fact that you're here on a time crunch today, so I'll consider that your last question and offer you now 2 minutes to make whatever closing remarks you'd like this room to hear.
Well, thank you so much. First, I want to thank you all for being here, and thank those of you watching this on video. I'm assuming you're posting this up. You know, I would like to say to you what we say to our teenage kids. What's the definition of insanity? Doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. I would say, if you're not happy with the direction Washington's going, the definition of insanity is putting a career politician back in office. It would be giving Kristen Holland, a 14-year career politician, a promotion and sending him to the U.S. Senate. Under his watch, the debt has more than tripled. It was $6 trillion when he took office, and now it's more than $19 trillion. I don't see a solution, and he opposes the balanced budget amendment. The health care, the Affordable Care Act, is not affordable. We need to reform our health care system, but standing by this program puts pop party over people. He voted for a $700 billion bailout of taxpayer money to Wall Street. and he voted for the Iran deal, and I have to tell you that is one of the reasons I got in this race. That shows that he is not standing for our ally, Israel, or standing up to our adversary, sending $1.7 billion worth of taxpayer money to Iran in cash, the largest state sponsor of terrorism across our globe. In the same time, in his 25 years in office, he's been talking about immigration, and nothing's happened, kicking the can down the road. Passionate about education, having a workforce that is ready for the new jobs of our era, and the regulatory environment that's tying the hands of business. I am a small business owner, wife, mom, grandma. I'd like to go to Washington to work for you, and I'm asking you on November 8th for your vote. I'm Kathy Szeliga, running for U.S. Senate.
Very tight schedule, and I hope we have accommodated your schedule. Big round.